and then some.
Amen.
He deserves everything you ever going to get. He deserves it. Amen. Amen. He is God. He is God. He is God. And he is good to us. And so we praise him today. We worship him today. We came to honor him today. We came to give him the glory because he is God. He is God alone. Beside him, there is no God. I don't care what people say. There ain't no God beside the true and the living God. And God, we came to honor you. We came to give you glory. We came to worship you. We came to say you alone are God. You sit on the circle of the earth, God. You are the one that looks down. You are the one that decides what's going to happen, God. We praise you. You are the creator of this universe. And if there be any other, you the creator of that too. Because there ain't nobody but you, God. And we worship. We praise you. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise because you are do it. You are do it. Every hallelujah belongs to you, God. Because there's nobody but you. Nobody can do what you do. Nobody's bigger than you. God, we thank you. We praise you that you allow us to be your children. We don't deserve it, but we thank you.
Yes.
And we pray in this moment that you would have your way.
Yes.
That you would move however you want to, God.
Yes.
It's all about you, Father.
Yes.
Get all the glory for yourself. We're your people. You are our God. We serve you.
Yes.
We are at your beck and call.
Yes.
So, Father, today we ask that you would speak, God.
Please,
and you would speak clearly, Lord. You would use my voice to speak with your voice, God.
Yes.
That none that I say would be of myself and of my own, God. But all of it would be of you, Father. Stand up in me. Think in my mind. Speak through my voice. Stand up in my body, God. Have your way. I am your servant, God. Have your way. Give us ears to hear, hearts to understand, and more than that, a will to obey your word. So that you get all the glory. No man can boast. You get the praise. You get the glory. You get the honor. In Jesus' name. People of God said amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Senior pastor, Reverend Dr. Clifford Wright, Senior, who is the love of my life. Amen. Amen. Yes. The Lord let us meet in August. It'll be 37 years. Hallelujah. We are thankful and thankful for these preachers of the gospel. The men and the women of the Lord are here. I'm thankful for all of you that thought it not robbery to come out to the house of worship this morning. But I do want you to know that I'm on business for the King.
Amen.
I came about God's business today, so we're going to go right to the Word of the Lord. If you have your Bible, we're going to go to Luke chapter 19 and look at two passages of Scripture. Luke chapter 19, go down to verse 35 to 37, and then we'll read 41 to 44. Luke 19, 35 to 37, then verse 41 to 44. I'll be reading from the New International Version for the Word of the Lord. Amen. When you have it, can you say amen?
Amen.
If you need more time, just say, wait a minute. Luke 19, 35. Are you with me?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen. So the Word of the Lord says, they brought it to Jesus, threw their cloaks on the colt, and put Jesus on it. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. Verse 41, as he approached Jerusalem and saw the city, he wept over it and said, if you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. The days will come upon you when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. They will dash you to the ground, you and the children within your walls. They will not leave one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you.
It's me, y'all.
Go ahead.
So we're just going to take a few minutes to ponder the question. When Jesus shows up, do you recognize him? When Jesus shows up, do you recognize him? So now, yes, I do know it's Palm Sunday. And it is all about the triumphal entry of Christ into the city that belonged to God. And all the hosannas and the blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, I know all about that. But God showed me the arrival of Jesus was perceived in one way by the crowd and in another way by Jesus Christ himself. And so I don't know about you, but I think it's more important to look at Christ's perception than the crowd's perception. Don't you?
Amen.
Amen. Because all too often we become worried about the world around us. Worried about the crowd instead of Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
And so God invited me to take a closer look at Christ's entry than I have really done before. So I invite you to look closer too. So now I'm not saying that we don't have no reason to celebrate, because we always have a reason to celebrate Jesus.
Amen.
He is not only the reason for the Christmas season, but he's also the reason for the Easter season.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. But we should know what we are celebrating and why. So as we move forward, we want to look at what's really going on here in this celebration of the Feast of Passover. And what is the reason for the people's exuberance here and their expectation of Jesus? We want to check what's their perception of what's going on, as opposed to what is Jesus' perception of what's going on. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, so let's look at the backstory to Christ's entry. He's already raised Lazarus from the dead, proving that he is God with the power over life and death. He's already healed blind Bartimaeus on the pit stop on the way from Jericho right on into Jerusalem. He's already told the parable of the people given the minas or the talents or the money, and told the difference between the one who buried it versus the ones who multiplied it. Amen?
Amen.
So we get a footnote right there. In that text, in that parable, we get a little glimpse of what God is looking for over and against of what we are looking for, and how we misunderstand and often misinterpret God's intentions toward us. And we show our misunderstandings when we bury instead of multiply.
Amen.
Just take
Amen.
That on hold.
All right.
So, you know how when we think stuff is all about us, but it's really all about the God who created us?
Amen.
So that thing is called perception, how we perceive, how we look at stuff. So Jesus is about to enter Jerusalem to complete the last part of his ministry and to fulfill this whole thing that he came for at the end of the Passover on the cross. So it is here in our text that it is the beginning of the Passover feast. At the church here, we call it Palm Sunday. But I think I'm going to change the name of it, at least for myself, and I'm going to call it the Set Aside Day.
Well,
because this day, when he enters Jerusalem is what's known as the 10th day of the Jewish month, Nisan. Okay. That is the day when the Paschal lamb was to be chosen and set aside until it was time for it to be slain. Some of y'all get it.
That's right.
So you know that lamb that they talked about in Exodus would be slain, and the blood of the lamb had to be put on the doorpost outside the house to keep the death angel from killing the people inside the house. That's the Paschal lamb. So this day that Jesus is going in is the 10th day of Nisan. And he is entering Jerusalem on this lamb setting apart day, the lamb setting apart day to be kept until the 14th day of Nisan, when it became the lamb slaying day, which we call the Passover.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And so the whole assembly, all the people of the tribes of Israel, are now gathered in Jerusalem to commemorate the day when God had delivered them from bondage by the killing of the lamb and putting the blood on the doorpost. That's why they're there. And so this is the reason, and this is the season that the text is talking about. So the people's celebration and perception is one thing, but I am sure that Jesus' perception is a total different thing.
Yes, yes.
So on this day, as they're approaching Jerusalem, Jesus has already put his plan into action and into motion to carry out what was going to occur, you know, for the end of the week, because, you know, he is God. And so he done already sent ahead his disciples to get this, you know, colt, this donkey that's tied up, and tells them, get there, get it, bring it to me. And if anybody asks you why you're doing that, then you tell them that the Lord has need of it, and keep on, and they'll let you bring it. You know, it, God ever asked you for stuff?
Amen.
Oh, he ain't never asked you. Okay. So they brought this donkey to Jesus, and they put their cloaks on it, and then they put Jesus on this donkey. So here's Jesus riding in on this set-aside colt that ain't never been ridden on into a town where he himself is going to get set aside. Amen.
Amen.
So he can be slain not just for the Jewish people, but for the whole world. That's me and you.
Yeah. Yeah.
So now let's look at the people's expectation and perception, because it says he goes along, they throw down their coats, and they're screaming and hollering and praising. And I said, well, that's not unusual, because it was usual to throw flowers and branches and put down carpets and cloaks and garments in the pathway of a conquering king and great princes when they came into town.
Yeah.
And it was to show great honor and respect to those persons. Mm-hmm. But see, what the crowd didn't realize was that a king who entered on a horse symbolized war and conquering.
Jesus.
But a king who entered on a donkey symbolized peace. Don't miss the point of Jesus' entry on a donkey versus a horse.
Yeah, yeah.
So the people, they're just going wild, and they acting like they welcoming in a warlord king. But it's the Savior that's coming in.
Amen.
Have you ever been expecting Jesus to show up like a king and he come in like a Savior?
Yes.
You know, and maybe he's coming to bring you peace instead of you want him to come in and win the battle that is against you. But maybe he's coming to win the battle that's within you.
Amen.
So this crowd has an expectation. They're welcoming their Messiah King. And with good reason. Because right there in the text it says they've thrown their coats down and waving and going forth and singing praising because, right there in verse 37, because or for all of the miracles that they have seen. They're praising because of all the miracles he has done.
Yes.
And their king is also a miracle worker. Isn't that awesome?
Yes.
And they had experienced these miracles. They had seen many of them with their own eyes. Their king got the power to do miracles, and they are sure that he is going to do miracles because they wanted him to, and they expected him to, because they knew that he could and that he was able. Amen.
Yes.
You on our behalf. He can come in and take this throne for himself and put the Jews back in control in their own homeland. That is their expectation and their perception. But how many of y'all know that just because Jesus is a miracle worker doesn't mean he gonna work the miracles?
Go ahead, go ahead.
Just because we tell him to.
Go ahead.
Or we want him to.
Go ahead.
I might get no amen right there.
Amen.
But I think, you know what? I found out about God. He do what he wants to when he get ready to.
Amen.
And he don't always do it when I say something.
That's right.
Because that makes him God. And not me.
Amen.
Amen. So then God said, well, now let's look at Jesus' perspective, because he got his own. And his perspective about this thing comes up there in verse 41. Now, you can read what's in between. It's okay. But it says that as he approached Jerusalem, he saw the city, and he wept over it. Now, I stop right there. I said, wait a minute. This is a celebration, and Jesus is weeping. Are these happy tears? I don't think so. I think these are sad tears. And this is the second time in scripture that we see Jesus weeping. The first time is when? At the tomb of Lazarus. And he's weeping over people. He's weeping over people who did not believe and people who did not truly know who he was. He wasn't weeping for himself. Anytime Jesus wept, it was over other people. I mean, the Bible doesn't even say that in the garden he wept for himself. It says he sweated drops that looked like blood because he was in agony. He travailed in prayer.
Oh, we need to learn how to pray.
But we don't get to mention that he wept even for himself at that time. So Jesus' weeping is significant, I tell you. And so for the second time, we find him weeping over people. Again, he's weeping over people. Why? Because they didn't know who he was. And after 3.5 years of ministry, on this day, this Palm Sunday, he shows up and they still don't know.
Amen.
I know it. And he tells us why he's weeping, because he said, if you had only known. So if you had only known tells me that they didn't know.
Amen.
Amen. And you know, not knowing is a bad place to be in.
Yes.
And thinking you know and you don't know is even worse yet.
Lord Jesus.
I ain't gonna tell you what my grandma said. But anyway, sometimes we just don't know because our perception and our expectation is faulty. We expecting one thing and it turns out to be another, and that makes the whole visit different than our expectation. See, because when you're looking for a king and you get a savior, your expectations are faulty. Because you're looking for your enemies to be conquered and you're looking to get back your stuff because you think Jesus is going to dominate those who stole it from you. That is an expectation you have of a king, a warlord, but a donkey riding savior is different from a warlord king. See, kings conquer. That means it's about others. And Jesus, he's about you. He's a savior. He's about you.
Amen.
And sometimes we need saving more than we need conquering.
Amen.
Because see, a savior keeps you sane while you're in your situation. He doesn't necessarily change things around you or take you out of your situation. See, a savior can keep you safe even when the surroundings don't change. And I found out that it is more powerful to be kept when you're in than to manipulate the circumstances around you. Now, I know that ain't what we want. I don't know about you, but we be praying, Lord, can you change these circumstances? Jesus. Lord, in fact, don't just change the circumstances, change these people too.
That's
right. You know? But one thing he showed me is that nothing will really change if you remain the same.
Amen.
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 If you change the stuff and don't change you, wherever you go, it's going to go right back to where it used to be, because there ain't no difference in you, and you're going to bring your same old mess over there in a new place, you're going to mess up that too. Oh, I can't get an amen right there. And then you're going to talk about everywhere I go, this is how people do, this is what people do to me. And they say it, I don't know why everybody always jealous of me. They always hating on me. Girl, because it's you. So that's why he got to change you sometimes, be a savior, fix you, and not the stuff. Okay, but we still talk about Jesus' perspective. So Jesus' perspective also gives us some insight into timing. Because his perspective has not only to do with knowing, but also with timing of things. Because see, sometimes timing is everything. He says, if you had known on what? This day. Mm-hmm. Jesus weeps not only because they don't know, but because they missed their timing. Yeah. See, often we miss our perfect timing. Yeah. I know there are some times that we let things pass by and we want to think that them things don't come back around again, but some things have what we like to call a due season.
Yes. Yes.
It's like planting.
Amen.
It's like planting season.
Amen.
And if I miss it, I can plant late.
Yeah.
But it won't have enough time to fully grow, and I'll find that I missed this planting season, and I'm going to have to wait till next time. Mm-hmm. I got to wait till next season. So when you miss your timing, I tell you, you miss God.
Amen.
You have to deal with the consequences of missing God. And I have found that missing God always brings sin your way.
Okay.
It doesn't mean that you won't be forgiven. But it does mean that if you miss God, you got to deal with the sin that can come because of the missing of God. And it doesn't mean that you won't be forgiven, because if we are saved, we have repentance at our disposal.
Yes, yes.
But we do not have time at our disposal. Because see, time marches.
Amen.
It marches on.
Amen.
Whether you sit down or not, whether you move or not, time still goes forward. And you can do something later, but you are different and the circumstances are different. It is not the same as the first time it came through. Oh, I know it right away. And see, the crowd in the text not only didn't know who Jesus was, but they didn't get the fact that the timing was right. They had the wrong expectation of this day. They was looking for war, and Jesus came to bring peace.
Amen.
He said, if you had known what would bring you peace. Most of the time, we don't know what would bring us peace.
Amen.
We think people, the right one. Places, right house. Things, right job. We think people, places, and things gonna bring us peace. But they don't bring you peace. You can't get peace till you get the prince.
Amen.
Amen.
And this peace that Jesus is speaking of in our text, it is no small thing. This peace, this eirene in the Greek, but the shalom in the Hebrew. Eirene or shalom, this is the kind of peace I'm talking about. I don't know about you, but when I got saved, God, I said, I want peace.
Yeah.
I had people, I had places, I had things, but I was still mixed up and messed up. On the inside, my mind was still crazy. I wanted peace, I wanted peace. And this shalom, this peace is the course and desire of every Jew. It is wholeness, it is wellness, it is tranquility, it is harmony, it is prosperity, it is safety, it is salvation. And that's what they longed for. Peace with God and peace of God. That kind of peace supersedes anything that we know about. That is God's peace. And God's peace is what gives you hope in the midst of any storm.
Yes.
Peace comes from his presence.
Yes.
When you know he's with you,
yes,
then you know you can deal with anything.
Hallelujah.
Peace is more sure than money.
Yes.
Peace is freedom. Amen. from worry.
Yes.
Peace lets you know you can make it because you're not alone.
Amen.
See, friends and family may not and cannot always be with you, even if they may want to. But some things you're going to have to go through, and it's just going to be you and God. Some things your husband, your spouse, your kids, your friends, they can't get it for you. You're going to have to know God for yourself.
Yes.
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 You're going to have to know peace when you see it.
Yes, my Lord.
You got to know where true peace comes from and who it comes from. And then you got to get on board with the peace at the right time.
Yes.
Jesus said, if you had known this day, what would bring you peace? But now, because you didn't know, it is hidden from your eyes. I said, wow, Jesus. See, the problem with not knowing and dealing with the right timing of something is that it keeps the unknown thing hidden to you. Not to everybody, but to you. Some people see some stuff you just don't.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, I know right.
Amen.
Got two people in the same office. Both of them got a pink slip, and one of them is like, ooh. Another one is like, God, I thank you because I know you got something else for me. I don't know what you're going to do. But that's the peace that you know. You just in the back, and it's hidden from you. So I said, Lord, why do you think it's hidden? And I said, did you hide it? He said, well, I didn't hide it. I came right there. Things that get hidden by us. I said, how so? By our stuff. Our stuff make us blind. And my blindness get caused by my mess.
Uh-oh.
What kind of mess? The scribes and the Pharisees give us a clue. They wanted to kill Jesus. I said, huh? Why? Because he seemingly took from them what they thought was important to them, their power and authority. See, when God come along and let something get slapped at your hand, who you gonna get mad at? See, he wants you to see, and your thing you holding got you blind. Stuff and things are blinders to Christ. See, and the need for power and control or our own way blocks and blinds our vision of the Christ and the vision that we should have of God's will for us.
Yes.
Even when I think I'm trying to get my life under control so I can offer a half-decent life to God, I have just blinded myself and hidden God from myself. Why? Because I can't see what he's doing. I can only see what I'm doing. And what I'm doing takes me further away from him because I'm looking down and around instead of looking up. But when I surrender my power and control to him, then I can see him because I'm looking up at him and I know what he can do because my focus is on him. And I can't get nothing under control by myself anyway.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
So when my expectation caused me to be looking for a king and I get a savior, then my unmet expectations will cause me to be blinded and then God's will becomes hidden. And then I miss God altogether. And see, here's the worst thing is that when I miss God, I reject God. Well, I ain't got an amen right there. See, we reject God by default when we don't accept what he do. And you can't accept what you don't see. You can't see it, so you can't accept it. But that don't mean he didn't show up.
Amen.
It just means that you didn't know him when he got there. It just means that I didn't recognize him. And see, non-recognition will cause me to miss and reject him. I reject what I can't recognize. And I can't recognize it when my unmet expectation is blinding me. That is why the same people in this crowd celebrating Jesus today in the text is the same ones who said crucify him 3 days later, because their expectation was one thing. Jesus came in another way. The way he came was hidden from them, and they said, this man ain't who they, he ain't who I thought he was.
Amen.
Missing God and his will that get hidden has some consequences over here today. Missing God gives the enemy room to come in and attack. Oh, it's right there in the text. Right. This is the part we don't like to read that Jesus is talking about. The days will come.
Yeah.
You might miss God today and it might seem okay, but some days is going to come.
Yes.
You might reject him today because you were blind with your stuff and you didn't see him, but some days are going to come. There's some days that he got hidden to you because you was turned looking at your own self and the devil came slipping in, killing up, dashing everything in your sphere. Your kids, your job, your money, everything you look up and it's messed up and it's broke up and you say, what's wrong, God? Why you let this happen to me? He said, you didn't know who I was when I came into your church, your back and you faced the devil and he came in here and took your stuff.
Come on.
Oh, God. See, we got to know him. We got to learn enough about him.
Amen.
To know him when we see him.
Amen.
We got to recognize him when he comes. And God began to deal me with this word recognize. I said, you know, anything that starts with re most of the time means again, right?
Yeah.
So re, again, cognize what? Identify. Mm. You identifying something or someone because you encountered them before. To the point that fake gods become obvious.
Amen.
I gotta know who he is enough to know that the fake ain't real.
Amen.
There was a man who could recognize a counterfeit dollar bill. I don't care where it was. He could recognize a counterfeit anytime he came in contact with it. And they said, how you know the counterfeit so good? You done seen all of them? He said, no, I don't know all of them, but I done studied the real thing so much, so long, so hard, that anytime you bring a fake thing to get me, I know it ain't the real thing. You have an accident the next day, the next week. Oh, I know how about it. Y'all have been there. I've been there. You let your coverage lapse with God and the devil come breaking in. And then you just out on your own trying to make it, trying to get an escape hatch. Don't know where it is. It's dark. Trying to get out because you done missed God and he said to shelter in place. Running out, stuck your head out, and got shot because you, oh God. because you did not recognize. But when I don't recognize, I learned a little something I should. I mean, I should have recognized. I should have known his voice. I mean, I needed to know what to do. I should have known what I was supposed to do. I should have went to the doctor and got my glasses. I know I needed some glasses. I was seeing okay, but I knew it wasn't good. And when you refuse to get your glasses because you don't like how they look and you don't want to have them on your face, because you think you're not as good looking with them. And you think, you know, glasses make you look a little nerdy, look goofy, not as cute. And then, you know, you finally go and you know, people make you get them because you can't see. And then you get them and then you put them on and you found like you've been missing a whole lot of stuff. And then you figure out that, you know, nerdy can still be cute. In fact, nerdy, cute, and smart is in. It's in with God. And then you say, well, what did I wait so long for? Because I wanted to do it my own way. Mm-hmm. When I knew that God's glasses was the best thing for me. But I just had to try. I had to try with my blind self missing God on the way. But one day I woke up and I said, God, give me your glasses because I don't want you to be hidden from me. I thought I wanted a king, but I know I need a savior. And I went through some stuff past me by that won't come back no more. I suffered some loss because I couldn't see it. But I'm better now. And when I get out of this mess this time, I tell you what, I'm going to keep on my glasses. I'm going to look for God everywhere I can find him. And I'm going to make sure I don't miss him next time he shows up. Because I don't learn my lesson. I'm going to make sure I listen. I'm going to make sure I can recognize him in a storm or a hurricane. I might have made a few bad mistakes along the way, and I know I did. I made some bad decisions, but I thank God he's still a savior. Yeah. And when I stopped playing and put on my glasses, I saw him and he still let me in. I'm older, I'm slower, I lost a few teeth along the way. But I'm here now. I went through some stuff, I bumped into some stuff that I didn't have to. I got caught in some places because I wasn't supposed to be there. Because I couldn't see good. Read the signs all wrong. Missed my doctor's appointment. And even when I went, I didn't want to wear my glasses. But I thank God for saving. I thank God for healing. I thank God for delivering. I thank God for waiting. I thank you that he didn't leave me out there. When I put it on and I could see him, he said, here I am. I said, I'm coming. I'm coming. I've been beat up. Hear me. We are standing on the cusp of the chip that they done already God, and then certainly some people who ain't got no better sense than to think it's okay. It's not all my medical information. The devil is a liar. The world is missing Jesus. But we don't need to be missing Jesus while the scientist is trying to find the God particle so that they can become gods on their own. Let me tell you, it is our moment to stand up for Christ. He is going to visit and real soon. He's going to arrive and real soon. You know how I know? Because the signs are already out there. This weather, this snow, this craziness, the trees don't know what to do, the animals don't know what to do, the groundhogs at my house came up and they went back.
Amen.